on that subject, I'm just going to turn to you now and talk to you about something that's occupied my mind and this podcast, and that's Scottish independence. And you're someone who kind of made me question what I think about it. Scottish independence, for those who are uninitiated, McClue, can you explain the background and what's happened here?
Well, the background is in 1707, the Scottish nobles had been fighting each other and setting fire to each other's castles and estates to the extent that they were bust.
Yes.
And, you know, they said that could they get some money, you know, trying to borrow some money. And they'd also had the Darien scheme, and the banking had been a problem. But a lot of people don't realise that Scottish banking, because Scotland led the world in banking, it was a Scot that actually founded the Bank of England, William Paterson.
Right.
And also founded the Bank of Scotland.
I see.
And it of course starts off with money. They had the Darien scheme where they had convinced everybody there was a new life abroad out in tropical climes. That became a South Sea bubble type thing. It just went pop, and a lot of the money was lost and a lot of people were stranded in South Sea climes.
Right.
So that was the end of the Darien scheme. Anyway, having said that, then you found out that Scottish banking, and people don't realise, it's never been backed up by reserves. So they are promissory notes. And a promissory note is actually a bill of exchange. I promise to pay the bearer on demand the sum of.
Right, so it was never representative of actual gold.
No, it wasn't, but people trusted each other. So they built up Scottish banking from that point of view. Anyway, in 1707, it was suggested that the Scots join with the English, and most people said no, but the nobles sold out for siller, which is a Scottish pronunciation of silver.
Mm-hmm.
They said, give us money and we will sign.
Right.
So they signed. Now, it's actually a rather poor piece of legislation, although having said that, the Act of Union has got some legislation that is very, very, risky for some existing institutions.
All right, like?
Well, for instance, there are clauses in the Act of Union that if something has been set up since the Union,
mm-hmm,
then there should be equal prominence given to both parties.
What does that mean?
What that means, it started off effectively with the Church, that the Church of Scotland should have the same power as the Church of England.
Okay, right.
Yes?
Yeah.
Now, we can also think about broadcasters in this.
Right.
So there could be a broadcaster who has been playing with fire.
The British...
When I say a broadcaster, I'm talking about a company.
The BBC?
Yes.
What? So they... How does the Act of Union affect the BBC?
Well, we need to look at that. I mean, that requires very, very big legal brains to sift through the Act of Union. But if you were to take it that if an institution has been started since the Act of Union in 1707, and of course the BBC was started by a Scot in 1922 as the British Broadcasting Company,
mm-hmm,
then there could perhaps be room for the legislation to be exercised that equal prominence should be given to both countries.
Equal prominence on the BBC should be given to Scotland and England.
Correct.
Right.
So that's an interesting one.
Isn't it just?
Yes. So now, I'm not saying that is the case. I'm just saying that could well be the case.
I see. It's a maybe. It's a possible.
It's a possibility.
You see, here's...
The legislation needs to be looked at. But in general, the Act of Union is a very poor piece of legislation. However, we've had 307 years of it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, along the line, it's not what the UK is at the moment. It's what it's become. And if you think about it, you have a situation where if you're in London, the reason you don't tend to go outside London much is because everything's there. My laces broke one day, I walked a few yards, and there was a leather key-cutting lace provider open to the street. He said, oh yes, sir, the number 7's, no problem at all. There you go, 40p, please.
Right, yes.
So, that was it. I didn't have to say, well, next time I'm in Manchester, or I'm in Glasgow, or Edinburgh, I'll pick up some laces for my shoes.
You've no need to leave London, and that's why they don't.
You have to leave it, and that's why they don't. But there have been many, many, many examples over the years when they have just called upon Scotland. For instance, English landlords came up and cleared the Scots away. All the farmers and peasants and everybody cleared off the land. So Scotland's depopulated. It's got about, 5,000 5.8 million or 5.2 million or whatever, right? Under 6 million. And you've got, in England, you've got almost 60 million.
Yes, there's a significant population difference between Scotland and
England. So England's getting rather overcrowded. Scotland is effectively depopulated. Having said that, the Scots were able to be very powerful in administrating the empire. Most of the steamships were built and the steamship companies were run by Scots. Most of the banks were run by Scots. So they're very, very pivotal. But then after Culloden in 1746, when the Cambucha Cumberland, who was King George's brother, was William, Duke of Cumberland. So you had the 15 and the 45. South of the border, they're known as rebellions. North of the border, they're known as risings.
Right.
Okay?
Yes.
So, anyway, we nearly had a Stuart back of the throne.
Right.
Yes, we nearly had a Stuart back of the throne, but we didn't. 1603 had seen the Union of the Crowns.
Yes.
The Queen costs us 52 pence a year. She's a fabulous lady. There's no need to be doing away with monarchy. There's your first myth.
Right, so hang on, I'm just following you. So you've told us the history of the country,
yes,
and you've told us that the problem is not what it is, but what it's become, the Union, and now we've brought the Queen into it, and this is one of the anomalies for me. I would have thought that an independent Scotland would reject Her Majesty the Queen.
Well, why would you? Because it's nothing to do with the Union of the Crowns, which was in 1603, and the King of Scotland became the King of the United Kingdom.
Yeah, well, that is the Union, isn't it?
That's the Union of the Crowns in 1603. Nothing to do with the Union of the Parliaments in 1707. Can you see the difference?
Well, I can now, but I would have thought that a lot of people who supported the Scottish independence movement would want rid of the Queen.
Well, no, this is where there is the ignorance. There will be people that wanted a Republic of Scotland, but in actual fact, that's not the issue at all. Because, for instance, after the coronation in June 1953, Queen Elizabeth attended a service in St Giles Cathedral for the honours of Scotland.
Uh-huh.
Yes?
Yeah.
And, of course, one of the honours of Scotland, there's the Sword of State, and you have dukes and earls who are the bearers of these jewels. Then you also had the Scottish crown appearing at the service. Now, there was a great amount of nervousness amongst the people in the south that the Scots may try to effect another coronation.
Right.
And make the Queen officially Queen of Scots, but she actually already is, by dint of the fact she is the Queen of the United Kingdom, Great Britain and her dominions beyond the seas.
So, this is why I don't get about it. So, you support independence, but at the same time, you simultaneously support the monarchy.
Well, I'm slightly different, because, as I say, I'm not actually a political animal, but I do want what's best for Scotland. So, yes, I am a big royalist. Of course I support the monarchy.
Right.
I think they're fantastic. And at 52 pence a year, I can't think of anything that's better value, because they bring in billions to this country.
Maybe the NHS, something like that, we could put it in there.
No, well, it's not like that. It's a separate budget. It doesn't exist that way. For instance, people say, all these big houses. Buckingham Palace has got 463 rooms.
Right.
Right? The Queen has to live there because that's the administrative headquarters for the state.
Right.
So what you've got here, if I can just nip back to the history and very quickly tell you, you have got at the moment what's known as constitutional monarchy. That's why you have Her Majesty's government and Her Majesty's opposition.
Yes.
We put an end in 1688 with the Glorious Revolution when King William came over, William and Mary.
Yes.
When they came over, that was an end to absolute monarchy when the king or the queen's word was law.
Right. So,
so can you see what's happening here?
There's
changes in history all the time, Nick, but there's a tremendous amount of ignorance about this because people have politics of envy.
Right.
Now, I'm interested in what's best for Scotland economically. For instance, I'll give you an example. We're talking about you don't need to go out London. In 1968, there was a hurricane that blew the roofs off so many houses in Scotland, people lost their lives.
Mm-hmm.
We had a Secretary of State for Scotland, the High Office, the Scottish officer of the government, right? of the cabinet. The Secretary of State, a gentleman called Willie Ross, a very formidable character, a tremendous character. And Willie Ross went to London to say, Scotland has been devastated by a hurricane. Can I have money to repair it? And they said, no, not really.
Right. I see. Yeah.
So that sort of thing. But then, in I think, was it 1986, Kew Gardens took a bashing?
Right.
With a storm?
Yes.
And there was tears in the news on this terrible, dreadful day when the trees have blown down in Kew Gardens.
There is an imbalance. I've got Scottish relatives. There's no doubt there's an imbalance. But I couldn't bring myself to support, tearing Great Britain apart. And that's kind of how
it's not actually tearing Great Britain apart. I mean, this is the whole thing. It will always be Britain. So it will always be British. But it's just from a political point of view saying, look, we are here. We want to control our own affairs because we know what we are doing. We also do not like the way a lot of Westminster is heading because we feel that things like the banks crashed. So you then have the Westminster Parliament saying we have to give our pals in banking back their money. And in reality, people's grannies are going into supermarkets where somebody's got a little gold stall and selling their wedding rings so that they can pay their electricity bill to people who are grabbing and grasping, who are also lobbying the Westminster Parliament. And that's how it's perceived, whether or not that's the case.
So if it's the best thing for Scotland, why does Scotland not agree with that?
Well, Scotland actually does agree with it. You see, there's misreporting going on here. For instance, we had an instance last week when the political editor had actually said that the First Minister had not answered a question when he actually had. Now, technology is clobbering the myth because people just switched straight from a broadcaster to YouTube or something like that so they could see what actually was said.
Yeah, but you accept that you lost the election. It's not going to be independent.
No, that's the whole point. People are saying Scotland voted against independence. Only just over half of it voted against independence. And a lot of that was people... Remember, not everybody turned out to vote, although the turnout was high, 80, 90% on occasions. But what you've actually got here is a situation that people are unhappy with because at the last moment they sent an ex-prime minister who had sold off this country's gold and taken us into recession up to tell people that they had to be very careful because if they were independent, there might be things like losing their pensions.
Yeah, if you're not careful, someone like me might sell off your gold. Do you know what? This is one of the things, Scotty, that struck me about it. And it's so strange. And I've always had a bit of a temptation towards the conspiracy theory angle with things. And when they sent those politicians over, I thought, could they send any less popular people in the world to try and make the case? Me being pro better together, I was horrified to see the likes of Gordon Brown and that go there. Do you think they managed to convince the Scottish people to vote no?
No, I don't think they managed to. Well, yes, did they manage to convince them? Well, effectively, yes. And the reason they did that was by saying, here are going to be all the problems, but if you come and stay with us, we will promise you the earth.
Yes, which they are, of course, not delivering on, and that was instantly apparent within about 24 hours, wasn't it?
Absolutely. So what I think could happen here, right, if the Scots think they've been duped, yes, because part of the referendum, remember, is getting right to people's hearts, minds and souls that they do not want to be duped by a national government.
Mm.
So what could happen is you very quickly have another referendum where you see, this time we are very, very wary of what's being reported in the media. See, Scotland doesn't have its own media, Nick. It's got satellite branches of a national media.
Yeah.
Now, that's a big problem. Scotland had its own media, but the owners of the radio stations sold them off. For instance, one of the biggest radio operators in Scotland is run from Germany.
Yeah, that's right.
And
the media industry is unlikely to
stand. Another one's run from London.
Yeah, because the media is owned by the Westminster Beast. There's no doubt about that. I've covered that before. The BBC's bias is neither left nor right. It's establishment bias.
It's establishment bias. It's the British Broadcasting Corporation. But the motto of the British Broadcasting Corporation, is... Nation shall speak peace unto nation.
Right. And do you think they managed to do that?
Well, sometimes one wonders. I mean, there are many, many, many great things about the BBC, but there are also a lot of things coming out that people are letting the BBC down. I mean, for instance, when we had the Iraq war and the weapons of mass destruction and all that, the government were facing absolutely right staring in the face of the people that ran the BBC.
Yes.
There was accusations that the governors had caved in. The evidence for that was that the Director General and the Chairman both resigned.
Yes.
And had to give apologetic speeches.
Yes.
Now, that's wrong. Your dichotomy with the BBC from 1922 is that the government are saying, can you be our mouthpiece? Can you be our propaganda machine? And it needs a very powerful person running the BBC to say, no, we can't actually be that. We have to be balanced and fair.
Do you ever feel that your talents have been used towards, propaganda in the past?
I don't think they have. No, I mean, the only thing my talents have been used for is commercial activity.
Mm-hmm.
I think I've probably made a lot of people very wealthy. I haven't, unfortunately, done that for myself. That's hopefully, something that may or may not appear.
I'm sure that's on the way. Couple of months from now, that'll all sort out. The check's going to clear.
But I've definitely enriched a lot of wealthy people.
Because you've mainly worked in commercial radio. Have you done any BBC work?
Yes, I've done quite a lot of BBC work. I mean, the BBC took Scotty McClue only for a short time because it's just so popular. Whoever's got McClue has the market, is the saying.
But it's an audience thing that's got people like me and you ever through the door of the BBC, though, because I just don't think we're on message enough.
Well, it's not a question even of being on message enough. As I say, why should a broadcaster have a political leaning you one way or the other? Why is this country so obsessed with labelling?
Yes.
Oh, yes, but he's a bit left-wing. Oh, yes, but he's a bit right-wing. Oh, but he's a little bit left of centre. He's a little bit right of centre. What do these terms actually mean?
They're marketing terms. They stick a label on you so they know what price they can sell you for.
Well, there is that, but also you've got people who regulate broadcasting thinking, can we make sure that we are on message establishment-wise?
Yes.
You see?
I think so.
Do we always have to be on message establishment-wise? Yes, we have to look after our country. Yes, we have to look after our country's security. Yes, we have to look after our country in terms of good manners.
Right.
In terms of language.
Yes.
So I think with freedom comes responsibility. So broadcasters have terrific responsibilities. People like you and I have always fulfilled our responsibilities. We've always taken them seriously.
That's true. I mean, yeah, we've not got into as much
trouble. We're not going to let the side down.
Yes, that's true. But
I think that what's happening is that people are not using us properly because we are customer-facing and they should be. We have access to all of their customers. We have access to their clients, who are the people.
I wonder. I've often wondered whether or not maybe you underplay the political side of things sometimes because people don't like you talking freely about politics.
Well, they should do.
Yeah, I agree they should do, but they don't seem to.
Because, I mean, politics are, in one way, the art of the possible. The other way to look at that is that politicians don't actually do anything. They talk about doing it.
Yeah, that's right. It does kind of expose some of their lies.
But I think that we also have a tremendous amount of ignorance with the public, and I say educate the public. Let the people speak. Entertain the public. Inform the public. Don't be frightened of it. Don't put a lot of boring nonsense that doesn't attract an audience on just so that you've got something keeping your transmitter warm.
Do you know what? I want to ask you my final question here. As we move forward into the new age, into the new era, what is on the horizon for Scotty McClue? What are you planning to do next?
Well, I think there's been a tremendous amount. See, Scotty McClue is never, ever short of offers. It's just some people don't know how to put a value on that particular product, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So they don't put the right value. So you'll get an idiot of a programmer phoning up and saying, would you come and work for us, Scotty? Because we love what you do and we love the audiences you attract. And I say, right, okay, I'm interested. Now, the only thing is we don't have any money.
Right.
And I think, well, what are you doing on the telephone? Plumber. And say, can you come round and put a whole new central heating system in my mansion? By the way, I don't have any money.
Yes. I mean, he should be worrying about how he's going to pay his phone bill as well, that guy.
He should be very worried about how he's going to pay his phone bill, because your problem is, what also managing directors and programmers don't realise, that they're only there by dint of the fact of how good their content is.
Yes.
Otherwise, they're going to end up, you know, back wherever they've come from.
I honestly think that their world is going to vanish, and I genuinely think that people like you and some of the other phone-in show hosts who are kicking around will ultimately end up doing what they do best on the internet. How exactly that comes about, I'm not sure yet, but it seems so just around the corner to me.
Well, Scotty McClure's always been ahead of his time, and it makes me laugh when people think, oh, is that not a bit of a sort of older thing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, Scotty McClure still hasn't even scratched the surface of radio for all the millions of people that have listened to the program.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it has been millions upon millions. But wherever he goes, he attracts an audience. He attracts an element of controversy. But he also, which I think is beautiful, attracts talkability.
Well, this is it, yes. I mean, and that's what I used to do. I would go into school the next day, having listened to your show, and then I'd try out some of the arguments, points of view, and so on, the debating skills, and it would all come back to me talking about what had happened on the radio the night before.
Yes, because you're playing fair. I mean, when the theme tune goes out at night, when we wish the audience a safe and peaceful good night and give them a big dinky-doo,
that's
everything's a kiss and make-up. Daddy has kissed it better, but don't think we won't be doing it all again the next night.
And that reminds me, I can't end this interview without saying dinky-doo to you.
Dinky-doo to you. Farewell, my dear friend, and we shall meet up very, very soon, because there are big, big things in the pipeline for Scotty McClure. Unfortunately, I can't discuss them all on this podcast.
Well, we haven't got time. Listen, it's been wonderful to talk...